Good morning.
Good morning
and happy Easter. Welcome to the First Universalist Church of Yarmouth. I am Ann Turner, member of the Worship Council, and I'm so glad to be greeting all of you on this happy spring morning. A warm welcome to everyone gathered here in our sanctuary, and a warm welcome to those of you who are with us on Zoom. At First Universalist, our mission is to explore our faith, embrace this community, and engage the world as spiritual seekers. May we take these words to heart. If this is your first time with our congregation, welcome to you. We invite you to fill out a connection card that's located in the pew in front of you, so we can connect you with all the programs here that might interest you. You can drop it in the offering plate when it is passed later in the service. For those of you joining us with young children, there is nursery care right through that door for babies and toddlers. And you are welcome to use it anytime you need it. Following our service, all are invited to join us for coffee hour, our time of friendship and fellowship downstairs in our gathering room. On this busy morning, we have four announcements. First, many thanks to all of those who baked, chopped, set up, cleaned up, and ate our farm supper last night. There were over 40 people involved in the prep and serving of that meal. And we raised about $2,700 so far. And an enormous thank you to Cindy and Sarah, who are our fearless leaders in that effort. Secondly, this Thursday, April 4th at 6:30, we are very happy to welcome Penobscot leader Sherry Mitchell to our sanctuary for an evening talk and discussion. Please join us for this very special event. If you haven't done so, there are copies of her book downstairs in the gathering room for you to borrow or take for our spring all-church read. Another quick announcement. There is a branch hanging in the tree out front in a precarious position. Pete has marked off, roped off places that it is probably not safe for anyone to walk. So keep your children and yourself out from under that tree. We don't need it to fall on anyone. And lastly, following the service today, kids are welcome to participate in our annual Easter can hunt outside on the church grounds. Once we find all the hidden canned goods, we donate them to the food pantry. There are also special Easter surprises awaiting. Now, I invite you all to take a deep breath. Stretch if you need to. As we settle into this time together, our music director, Sam, and the choir will lead us into worship. Thank you.
you so much, choir. Good morning, everyone. Happy Easter. How are you? The sun's out. Yeah, how about that? Alleluia, indeed. And we are alive and risen here in this room together, celebrating our precious lives. Alleluia, again. I'm Reverend Hillary. I serve as the minister here, and it is with peace and friendship and yet another alleluia that I say, whoever you are, wherever you're from, whomever you love, whatever it is you've done, you are welcome here. And we're so glad that you're here in peace and friendship with us this bright morning. Today, on this high, holy Easter springtime day, we offer you a service of joy and solemnity, of music and silence, of scripture and prayer, of mystery and awe, all of it in celebration of life and the complexity, the possibility, the goodness, and the million dreams that come with being alive and continuing to come back. Always to life. Our opening words this morning are from the poetic farmer Wendell Berry. It's not specifically an Easter poem, and yet it is my favorite Easter poem. Today I share an excerpt from his manifesto from the Mad Farmer Liberation Front. Friends, every day do something that won't compute. Love the Lord. Love the world. Work for nothing. Love someone who does not deserve it. Give your approval to all you cannot understand. Ask the questions that have no answers. Invest in the millennium. Plant sequoias. Put your faith in the 2 inches of humus that will build under the trees every 1,000 years. Expect the end of the world. Laugh. Laughter is immeasurable. Be joyful, though you have considered all the facts. Ask yourself, will this satisfy a woman satisfied to bear a child? Will this disturb the sleep of a woman near to giving birth? Go with your love to the fields. Lie easy in the shade. Rest your head in her lap. Swear allegiance to what is nighest in your thoughts. As soon as the politicos can predict the motions of your mind, leave it. Leave it as a sign to mark the false trail, the way you didn't go. Be like the fox who makes more tracks than necessary. Some in the wrong direction. Practice resurrection. Good morning, friends. Happy Easter. As we practice resurrection, let's turn now to our neighbors and wish them a good morning. Perhaps you can ask them what Easter means to them in a UU context. And friends, will you rise now with me in body and spirit and join in singing our opening hymn, number 270, O Day of Light and Gladness.
Thank you.
And remaining risen, will you join me in the words of our unison affirmation? They're written in our order of service. We are united in seeking to increase love with justice and to constitute a free church open to all people, mindful of our past and drawing upon modern knowledge. We respond to the spiritual needs of persons and are devoted to the common good in community, nation, and world. We cherish the integrity of each individual and search for truth with reason as our guide. We respect differences of opinion and strive to be a democratic community. We are concerned with this world and open to the future.
Thank you. You may be seated, and I welcome our friend Gwen up to light our chalice this morning. Good morning, Gwen.
Good morning. Oh, you can hear me? Great. Good morning. Any children want to come forward and help me light the chalice this morning? Hi, Mia. Hi, Jetta. Hi, come on up. So cool to see you all this morning. Did anyone have the Easter Bunny visit them today? Yeah? Awesome. Yeah?
So,
you're not sure. Maybe later. Yeah. Oh, look at you. Hi, good morning. Okay, so we're going to light our chalice all together, and then when we're done, we'll blow out the match and make a wish. We light our chalice in peace and friendship. Okay, make a wish. All right, thanks. You can go sit down. Thank you.
And in the midst of the joy of the beginning of our service now, we pause to have a time of quiet in meditation, to truly feel the brightness of the sanctuary and the thrum of life within us and within this room. This time of quiet can be a moment to reflect on the past week or look forward to what might come in the days ahead. It could be a time to offer a prayer for someone in need of a prayer, or a time to simply be here now. Following our quiet, we will have a time of lighting candles. But first though, friends, will you join me in taking a deep, refreshing breath in, a calming breath out, and join me in a sacred time of silence. This time, all are welcome to come forward and light a silent candle for the prayers and the meditations you keep today. Though we'll not be sharing our feelings out loud this morning, our gathered community and I hold your joys and sorrows with you today and every day. If you'd like to light a candle, come forward, take a candle from the basket, light from our chalice, and place it in the box of our collective sand. We ask that as you place candles, you begin at the far end of the pot and gradually move towards the pulpit, being careful never to reach over a flame. And if there's a child with you this morning who'd like to light a candle, please accompany them as they do. For our friends joining us virtually, please write in the chat if you'd like to light a candle if you'd like to have a candle lit for you in the sanctuary this morning. And I also invite you to light candles at home at this time. Does anyone wish to light a light this morning?
Thank you.
Will you take a breath and join me in a time of prayer, my friends? As we reflect on all the meaning held in these flickering lights, and feel whatever is moving through our own hearts and minds this morning, as well as throughout the world we live in, I invite you to join me now in a prayer of loving kindness, a prayer meant to surface the limitless compassion that we all miraculously possess. If you like, you can repeat these lines after me out loud, or silently to yourself, or just listen and let them move through you. We'll recite this prayer three times, first for ourselves, next for others, and then for everybody. If you like, as we say this prayer, you can visualize these words of loving kindness catching that fresh spring breeze outside and moving across the earth, embracing all who needs to hear them, embracing everyone. In fact, Joanna, would you mind opening the window there so the breeze can catch our words? Thank you, my friend. Will you once again join me in taking a breath of fresh air and recite these lines with me? Taking a moment to feel whatever is moving and going on within you. May I be free from fear. May I live in love. May I share in joy. May I make peace. Letting thoughts of people far away you do not know, people close by you do not know, people you do know, people right here, letting those all swirl around you. Join me again in this prayer. May you be free from fear. May you live in love. May you share in joy. May you make peace. Feeling within, feeling everyone around, feeling it all. May we be free from fear. May we live in love. May we share in joy. May we make peace. Let it be so, and amen. And I once again invite our friend Anne up now to introduce our offering. Thank you, Anne.
Today's half plate is shared with our minister's discretionary fund. Given the high costs of food and housing and medical care, there are people in our community that are struggling to make ends meet. The minister's discretionary fund provides confidential assistance to those facing such financial burdens in our congregation. If you are in need of financial assistance right now, please let Reverend Hillary know. And if you are able to give today to support the minister's discretionary fund, thank you so much for your generosity. Your offering is important to our congregation and greatly appreciated. For those in the sanctuary this morning, we'll be passing the offering plate to one another. For those gathered with us online, you are invited to make your offering using the donate button in your order of worship or by dropping a check in the mail. Thank you so much.
close my eyes and I can see the world that's waiting up for me, that I call my own. Through the dark, through the door, through when no one's been before, but it feels like home. They can say it all sounds crazy. They can say I lost my mind. I don't care if you call me crazy. We can live in a world that we design. 'Cause every night I lie in bed, the brightest colors fill my head. A million dreams are keeping me awake. I think of what the world could be, a vision. There's a house we can build, every room inside it's filled with things from far away. Special things I compile, each one there to make you smile on a rainy day.
Gotta collect myself for a minute.
Thank you so much, choir. Thank you, Diana. Thank you, Sam. Whew. Will you rise with me now in body and spirit once again and join in our song of thanksgiving? So much to be grateful for in this life. So much for your generosity.
Good morning. Happy Easter. Today, children and youth will soon be invited downstairs to do some special Easter crafts and to play some games. And then, after the service, all children and youth are invited to participate in our Easter can hunt.
Ooh. Yes. Ooh. This year, just like last year, instead of hunting for Easter eggs, we're going to be hunting for canned foods and other items. These items are hidden outside all around for children and youth to collect. After they've collected the cans, we'll donate all of the items to the Yarmouth Food Pantry. And there will be some small special prizes to take home for anyone who helps us to collect the cans.
I love it. But first, let's say a blessing together on this Easter morning. Any children who want to come forward now can be a part of this blessing.
Hey, everybody.
Come on down.
Come on down.
Hillary, Mac, and I will begin. We'll take turns saying the words that are printed plainly. You have an insert in your order of service this morning, and you'll say the words printed in bold. We'll all say them together.
Readying ourselves into this time of blessing. If you guys want to turn around and face everybody, maybe that's a little scary, I don't know. They're pretty, it's a pretty nice looking group of people, if you ask me. You can look this way, that's fine, there's no rules. May the canned goods and other food that you, my friends, collect help nourish those in our community.
May we all be nourished.
May the gifts you receive after our Easter hunt has concluded bring your life sweetness and joy.
May we all have sweetness and joy.
May your basket always be full enough that you are able to share your bounty with others, especially those whose baskets do not contain as much.
May we all share freely.
May your life be interwoven with others, partaking in a community that both celebrates and mourns together.
May we all live in beloved community.
May our lives and this Easter morning together indeed be blessed.
May we all be blessed.
Yes, indeed. May we all be blessed this Easter morning and every morning.
And speaking of blessings, let's say our children's blessing together. We are
Unitarian Universalists, people of open minds, loving hearts, and helping hands.
Alrighty, let's head downstairs.
Have fun, everybody. See you after for the can hunt.
Thank you.
Our reading this Easter morning is by the theologian, poet, and peace activist Padre Gotoma. It's entitled Oremus. So let us pick up the stones over which we stumble, friends, and build altars. Let us listen to the sound of breath in our bodies. Let us listen to the sounds of our own voices, of our own names, of our own fears. Let us name the harsh light and the soft darkness that surround us. Let's claw ourselves out of the graves we've dug. Let's lick the earth from our fingers. Let us look up and out and around. The world is big and wide and wild and wonderful and wicked, and our lives are murky, magnificent, malleable, and full of meaning. Oremus, let us pray. In 1945, a young Egyptian farmer was digging for fertile soil in the dry hills along the Nile, when suddenly his shovel clinked against something that did not sound like a rock. Upon further excavation, he dug up a ceramic jar, and inside of it found more than 1,000 pages of rolled up manuscripts, ancient texts written on papyrus in the ancient Egyptian language of Coptic. Slowly, and at times mysteriously, violently, and dramatically, word passed of this discovery. And as news spread amongst black market traders, antique dealers, and religious leaders, it eventually reached the world of ancient historians. And somehow, a group of scholars were able to collect and translate these texts. What they found in doing so was that this young farmer had unearthed a trove of scriptures and philosophical books, essentially a library of sacred texts dating back 2,000 years or so to the age when the Gospels and the books that would someday become the New Testament were being written. Some of these works were familiar, an excerpt from Plato's Republic, for instance, but many were new, and many expounded upon the life and teachings of Jesus, his apostles, and books of the Old Testament. Named for the location where it was found, the Nag Hammadi Library, as it's come to be known, most notably included additional gospels beyond those we know today in the Bible. Some of us here might be familiar with a few of these texts, like the Gospel of Thomas, or the Gospel of Philip, or the Gospel of Truth, which tells the Genesis story from the perspective of the serpent. Some of us might know these books as the Gnostic Gospels. It is believed that the 52 books in the Nag Hammadi Library were compiled and buried by a community of desert monastics sometime in the 4th or 5th century. Why these books were buried in a pot in the desert is up for debate. There are many catacombs in the hills and caves along the Nile, and it was possible the pot was buried as an offering at a gravesite. More likely, though, these texts were buried so they could be hidden as arguments about orthodoxy were taking place amongst religious and imperial powers back then. Many of the Nag Hammadi texts uplift an idea heretical to the orthodox bishops and imperial authorities of the age, a theology that said humans need not look outwardly to God, but rather inwardly, for each of us, by our very nature, is already divine. A theology that might resonate with a few UUs in the room. The authoritarian powers that be back in those days did not like this theology. If all people have the capacity to look within and find the wisdom, power, and goodness of the divine already present in us, what does that do to the terrible, horrible, no good, oppressive, we are God, you are not hierarchy these imperial forces capitalized upon? One of the most mysterious and exciting texts in the Nag Hammadi is a long poem called The Thunder, Perfect Mind. And it very strongly echoes this sentiment of the divine wisdom, power, and authority humans naturally possess. Thunder is striking, though, on more fronts than this. Along with declaring divine power and goodness of humanity, this sacred text also acknowledges the suffering and the pitfalls of being human, ultimately offering a sweeping statement on the complexity of what it is to be alive. Thunder, Perfect Mind is about 9 pages long, written in the first person, and almost entirely composed of contradicting I am statements. One stanza, for instance, reads, "I am both awareness and obliviousness. I am humiliation and pride. I am without shame and I am ashamed. I am security and I am fear. I am war and peace. Pay attention to me." Thunder is a text that denies absolutes, a text that engages the complexity of identity, a text that dissolves the divide between class, culture, sacred, and profane. And one of its most notable features is that Thunder bends the bounds of gender. The voice of the poem speaks in a feminine voice sometimes, and a masculine voice at other times, and a neutral voice, moving from lines that begin, "I am she who," to "I am he," to "I am." No other text from that age has been found that does anything like this. That is to say, crosses all boundaries with such dynamic authority, vulnerability, and just straight up realness. In a moment, we will hear and then read together an excerpt from Thunder, Perfect Mind, and you will quickly make note of all these dramatic shifts in voice and tone. The power of Thunder, Perfect Mind, though, comes when we ask ourselves the question, who is the I that makes these I am statements? The poem could be read in the voice of a god, but an imperfect god who suffers. It could be read as a conversation between multiple different voices. Or perhaps the stanzas of this poem are meant to be read collectively as a great thundering chorus of people living under empire who are claiming their power and speaking truth to the vast complexity of their lives and identities. When we explore this text together this morning, you perhaps will hear and feel all of these voices, all of these identities, all of this life. And on the topic of life, my friends, I speak of Thunder, Perfect Mind today on this fresh and springing Alleluia of an Easter morning because to me, this is an Easter text. As UUs, there are lots of ways we can make sense or make no sense out of Easter. To me, though, simply put, Easter is a holy day that celebrates life, the power of being alive, the acceptance of life, and the coming back, and coming back, and coming back, and coming back, and coming back to life, against all the odds. Thunder to me is also a UU source. It is a social liturgy informed by a universalist theology that claims no life is of lesser worth than another life. More than any other year, I reached for Thunder Perfect Mind this Easter because this text was likely voiced by Middle Eastern people living in times of violence, cultural destruction, and diaspora, traumatic war-torn conditions that rage on without ceasefire as we speak this very minute. Sure, this text is ancient, but its contemporary meanings are great. Thunder is a transformative text attempting to mend the tattered threads of life in an age of constant tearing and fraying. And we can certainly bring Thunder close to us here in America right now, as we too live in a transformative age of rending and mending and rending and mending and rending and mending. Thunder, Perfect Mind, resonates especially loudly on this day, March 31st, which has been named the Transgender Day of Visibility in our country. A day that not only affirms the life of transgender people, but celebrates the dissolution of binaries, the complex truths of our identities, and the dynamic possibilities inherent in just being alive and who you are. And so, enough with the introduction. Let's get to it, huh? Let's check out this good, weird, divine, human, heretical, and healing poem, Thunder, Perfect Mind. I'm now going to invite Sam and Kai and Anne and John up to read an excerpt from Thunder. And as they get ready, friends, I invite you all once again to just take a breath, settle in, just let this text wash over you, resonate within you, disorient you, perhaps even comfort you.
I was sent out from power. I came to those pondering me, and I was found among those seeking me. Look at me, all you who contemplate me. Audience, hear me. Don't chase me from your sight. Don't ignore me any place, any time. Be careful. Don't ignore me.
I am the first and the last. I am she who is honored and she who is mocked. I am the mother and the daughter. I am the limbs of my mother.
I am both awareness and obliviousness.
I am humiliation and pride.
I am security and fear.
I am war and peace.
I am a foreigner and a citizen of the city.
Pay attention to me.
Do not laugh at me in the lowest places.
I myself am compassionate.
And I am cruel.
Watch out.
Do not be afraid of my power.
I am she who exists in all fears and in trembling boldness.
I am he from whom you hid.
And you appear to me.
Receive me with understanding and heartache. Take me from the disgraced and crushed places.
Come toward me, you who know me, and you who know the parts of me. The spirit of all men exists with me, and the women live in me.
I am the power of powers. I am the coming together and the falling apart. I am the knowledge of my name.
Listen, then, audience, and also you angels. Learn from my words, you who know me.
I am what everyone can hear and no one can say. I am the name of the sound and the sound of the name.
We got a ribbon. We got a couple ribbons. Yeah. All right, we got a few ribbons. Okay, that's all right. Thunder perfect mind.
I feel like we should rumble our feet together for thunder. Oh, what did you notice? What did you, did anybody notice anything? You're just trying to make sense of that the whole time? Someone's, oh, oof, yes, some, yes, that. The coming together. Hearing this text in a single voice and in a collection of disparate voices, we can hear how it might be a teaching, might be a plea, might be a prayer of contrition or empowerment, might be a statement about the messy, murky truth of things. Now, though, my friends, we will explore Thunder Perfect Mind as a thundering chorus, a collective declaration of a people, all of whom are individuals, and all of whom are part of a greater whole. Earlier this morning in our time of prayer, we thought about those far away we do not know, those close by we do know, and ourselves, all of us, coming together as one. Perhaps we can hold that thought in our mind once again as we read this poem. For our friends on Zoom, I believe Joanna is going to put this in the chat for you so you could read it at home if you like.
I need a copy. I know you probably all think I have all the scriptures memorized. I don't yet.
All right, so you don't have to say this if you don't want to, but I have to ask on this Alleluia of an Easter morning as we sit here awake and alive, why not? Why not read it? Let's read it. And I want to invite you once again, as we do read it, to rise in body and spirit as our collective thundering chorus. And read it like you mean it, with feeling, feeling it all, feeling the full complexity of what it is to be alive in this shared world. Taking a breath. I was sent out from power. I came to those pondering me, and I was found among those seeking me. Look at me. All of you who contemplate me, audience, hear me. Don't chase me from your sight. Don't ignore me any place, any time. Be careful. Don't ignore me. I am the first and the last. I am she who is honored and she who is mocked. I am the mother and the daughter. I am the limbs of my mother. I am both awareness and obliviousness. I am humiliation and pride. I am security and I am fear. I am war and peace. I am a foreigner and a citizen of the city. Pay attention to me. Do not laugh at me in the lowest places. I am compassionate and compassionate, and I am cruel. Watch out. Do not be afraid of my power. I am she who exists in all fears
and in trembling boldness. I am he from whom you hid, and you appear to me. Receive me with understanding and heartache. Take me from the disgraced and crushed places. Come toward me, you who know me, and you who know the parts of me. The spirits of all men exist with me, and the women live in me. I am the power of powers. I am the coming together and the falling apart. I am the knowledge of my name. Listen then, audience, and also you angels. Learn from my words, you who know me. I am what everyone can hear and no one can say. I am the name of the sound and the sound of the name.
Beautiful. Thank you all so much. You may be seated. If you would like to check out the full text of Thunder Perfect Mind, you can find it on the internet with a whole lot of essays, one of which is floating around by someone named Alexis Waller, who knows a little bit about this text. Thank you for helping me, Al. I appreciate your Coptic skills. They finally came in handy. So, let us pick up the stones over which we stumble, friends, and build altars. Let us listen to the sound of breath in our bodies. Let us listen to the sounds of our own voices, of our own names, of our own fears. Let us name the harsh light and soft darkness that surround us. Let's claw ourselves out from the graves we've dug. Let's lick the earth from our fingers. Let's look up and out and around. The world is big and wide and wonderful and wild and wicked, and our lives are murky, magnificent, malleable, and full of meaning. Oremus. Let us pray. Happy Easter, beloveds, beloved thundering friends. How good it is to be alive, practicing resurrection every day together. Come back, beloveds. Come back, come back, come back, and keep coming back to this precious life and the million dreams for the world that we're gonna make. Let it be so, and amen. Our choir will sing a response to us now of peace.
Thank you, choir. Will you all join me once again, rising in body and spirit, to sing the closing hymn of our Easter service, number 61, Lo, the Earth Awakes Again. And I want to invite you on all the alleluias of this song. If you want to get out those ribbons and spin them around for the alleluias, why not? Remain risen, friends, for our closing benediction and prayer. May all beings be free of suffering and the causes of suffering. May all beings experience profound joy and the causes of profound joy. May all beings be nourished so that they can flourish, and may all of us get free. Will you join me in the words of our unison benediction written in your order? For those who come here seeking God, may God go with you. For those who come embracing life, may life return your affection. For those who come to seek a path, may a way be found and the courage to take it step by step. Amen and alleluia. Happy Easter, everyone. The service begins when the service ends.